Surviving the Aftermath is a post-apocalyptic city management game. Players manage various things to sustain their city and gradually build it out. Gameplay. Typical tasks for this genre, like resource collection, building, and tech tree advancement, felt standard. There weren't any novel features that stood out to me. Meanwhile, its main problems weren't catastrophic flaws, but a series of issues that diminished its appeal, making it seem subpar overall when compared to similar games. I don't see the point in covering generic mechanics that everybody who's played a game like this has seen before. I also don't want to make this review a deep dive into every single flaw it has, so I'm only going to cover four different issues quickly. GUI design, the tutorial system, pop-up warnings, and random events. GUI design. In management games, quick menu navigation is crucial because any shortcomings hindering efficiency do become annoying over time. Unfortunately, this game did have such shortcomings. For instance, a city gradually sprawls out as it's built. Consider quickly locating a specific building in that uniform-looking sprawl to issue a command, clicking a UI button, selecting another to access a building list, sifting through options, and finally choosing to show this building from the on-screen text. Then the player can issue it commands. This five-step process is far from efficient. Such gameplay issues also highlight missed opportunities for simpler, more intuitive solutions. For instance, tailors are needed because they generate clothing. Survivors need clothing to stay healthy and happy. An intuitive approach would be clicking the jacket icon, which is already permanently displayed, to directly navigate to the tailor's location. If multiple tailors exist, a drop-down menu could be shown. This method would noticeably reduce navigation time, and thus tedium, enhancing playability. Unfortunately, the game lacks such efficient features. Others out there don't, and I did briefly search for GUI-altering mods, but found none to help this game. Tutorial. Even similar games usually vary in their finer details, so I often will turn tutorial tips on. The tutorial's advice often arrives too late to be useful, rendering it ignorable. Despite this, most things are straightforward and easy to figure out. But I did experience occasional confusion around a couple of mechanics, such as the malnutrition warnings. They were a little quirky. Survivors frequently develop malnutrition, despite being on an apparently sufficient diet, the meat meal recipe. Yet that status had no apparent significant impact on my town's prosperity. Its population continued to expand rapidly, necessitating more housing. Random complaints even appeared from townspeople. They were upset about how large it had grown, and it was only growing. Still, there was that negative status. A warning pop-up even told me to make the survivors more nutritious food, but I wasn't sure what it meant by that. Things seemed fine. Plus, the game also sometimes did give me false warnings. So, I ignored the idea that this was a problem for a while. I just kept having a growing, thriving, and relatively happy town. Ultimately, though, malnutrition might as well have been ignored. It turned out that the survivors needed a specific recipe which included veggies in their diet, the mixed meal. They got it. The town continued to thrive as it had before. Not much seemed to change, so it was pretty irrelevant. Warnings. The game sometimes pesters the player with false warnings. For example, the game kept pestering me to build more storage, even though there was plenty of storage space. Colonists freak out and drop stuff during random attacks from wildlife, and then they don't bother going back to pick stuff up fast enough. Stuff rots if it's left on the ground, so those game warnings about storage. They're just not catching on to the whole drop and panic routine. Random events. Disasters such as diseases or meteor strikes are par for the course. It's nothing new. Bad stuff happens, the player deals with it. But the entry gate's random events were a mixed bag. Often an event was fine, such as when random survivors showed up. That added interest to the environment. At other points, random events didn't enhance the game. For instance, these mercenaries showed up often. No matter what, this random event was a repeated choice between either losing supplies through placating the mercs or losing survivor happiness by refusing their demands. In context, that was a lame encounter. I built a gate so tough that murderous mercs didn't even want to try to breach it. But the guards staffing the gate were always going to be sitting ducks. Train ducks, which couldn't even get a shot off at people in non-bulletproof vehicles, which had to do U-turns to leave and then drive away in the open. That did harm immersion in the same way several times. There's a new quest. The main storyline involves the construction of a doomsday bunker and dealing with a generic threat that felt tacked on and uninspired. Its narrative and world-building didn't add meaningful depth or engagement. Instead, it seemed like another missed opportunity to me because its post-apocalyptic setting had underutilized story potential. Meanwhile, the win goal itself also seemed strange. In a post-apocalyptic setting, the worst is usually over with. At best, that meant that adding in a gigantic doomsday bunker seemed like an unnecessary insurance policy, which also hadn't worked for those who tried to use it in the past. The justification for it in-game was weak. Altogether, it felt like it was slapped on for the sake of a builder game having a quest of build big thing. That's workable, but it is definitely mediocre. Mechanically, the Doomsday Bunker was strange too. It shielded the town against disasters, but those were already mitigated against. Yet it didn't shield survivors from the harshness of winter. That made little sense in context, because the bunker was supposed to be fully sustainable with life support measures. If the bunker couldn't even be a place to bunker down safely during winter, then what use was it? It was empty real estate left to sit unused in or near the town. Again, it just makes it seem like a mediocre element. Didn't seem very thought out. The look and the sound. The game's visuals didn't impress me either, whether I was zoomed in or out. Zoomed out, the buildings blended together, which is standard but unspectacular. Zooming in revealed more details, albeit a mixed bag. There were gems, like the dilapidated school bus serving as a school, yet creative post-apocalyptic designs were the exception and not the norm. I also encountered glitches, like an eldritch mass of cows and odd moments where patrolling guards would stroll outside and passively watch battles at the gate and undermine the immersion. Plus, surviving the aftermath was similar to Frostpunk in many ways, in how it handled heating buildings via heat burners set outdoors, its visual novel-style pop-ups, the artwork style in those pop-ups, its theme being post-apocalyptic, and more. I couldn't help but compare the two games unintentionally while playing. And despite my mixed feelings about Frostpunk, its unique visual style left a positive, lasting impression. As a result, comparisons with it further highlighted another thing that surviving the aftermath lacked: a distinct, interesting visual identity. The lack's disappointing, especially considering that it seems as if this game's parent company could have easily afforded and allowed for it to have had the necessary budget to stand out visually too. As for its sound, it was a mixture of good and bad elements and just kind of mediocre overall. Its narration often didn't match the text it was meant to narrate. The difference was sometimes subtle, sometimes not, but odd either way.
The endeavor soon turns sour as the scope of the project dawns on people. Mistakes pile up, caused by the lack of know-how.
Its sound effects were fine, though nothing seemed noteworthy to me. It blended in quite well. Its soundtrack had options. The type of music could be changed or turned off on its radio setting. However, no track seemed amazing to me, and one station, Skylights, actually seemed mismatched. It was pretty, airy lo-fi music mixed with jazz. Yet it had some tracks where people whispered things like, "I know you." That was odd to randomly hear as I was constructing two-story houses and water pumps. The other radio stations just had the characteristic ambient tracks one might expect in a management game. My opinion is that overall, it's okay, but a player could just put on their own music and not miss out. Time and cost. Normally, it's about $30 and about $9 on sale. I think that $30's too much, considering that there are many games out there which are similar or better for around the same or less. $9, that seems okay. It takes about 21 hours to beat, at least that's how long I took. Your own mileage can vary widely either way. Final thoughts. Overall, I think it's generic at best and flawed at worst. Without standout positive elements to redeem its shortcomings, it falls short of being a memorable addition to the genre. It doesn't fully realize its potential. As a result, it's not terrible, it's not unplayable, but it really doesn't meet expectations in a lot of little ways that just detract from its quality over time as it's played, ultimately less engaging than other similar games. I do think it's worse than average for a city management game. I debated even rating its story because it seemed like a weak last-minute addition that might as well not even be included in the game, yet it does have a storyline, which could have been a lot better. If there is a story, and the game could have been a lot better if it were improved, then I think it should be rated, and if people want to ignore that category, then go ahead and ignore it, but that's my opinion. Either way, the total final rating still would have averaged out to a 3 overall.